So today I'm going to talk to you about the power of new materials discovery, specifically with respect to a category of materials known as superconductors, which have the potential to transform the energy landscape. So this is a picture of the night sky, and the bright regions you see on here are where energy consumption is maximum. You can see this is concentrated in urban areas, whereas energy actually needs to be transported from over the entire globe just to reach these areas. So energy transportation is a big issue. And let's talk about electricity in particular, because we know this is going to grow as a fraction of the total energy consumed. Renewables are an excellent source of electricity. But it turns out that renewables are located at remote locations, which are the opposite ends of the globe from where urban areas of consumption are. So looking forward, electricity infrastructure is going to change, and it's going to be dominated by issues of transport and issues of storage. We need to transport electricity now thousands of miles instead of hundreds of miles, and we need to store this electricity because where renewable sources are peaked, for example, when the sun shines the strongest or when the wind blows the hardest, this is not the same time when demand is peaked. So to be able to match supply and demand needs energy to be stored. Now these two, electricity transportation and storage, these are just a couple of the applications of this exciting family of materials known as superconductors. So these materials transport electricity without any loss. So if you took a ring made of superconducting wire and sent current through it, it would flow for the age of the universe. So if we go back one, excellent, thank you. So the image on the left shows a prototype of a superconducting cable that's to be used in Germany. That's going to be a kilometer long, and it's going to be underground and transport power. And so superconducting cables are a natural, and they have natural applications in power transmission given their zero loss, particularly for long distances, for dense urban areas, for underground transport. And DC technology in particular is making these now viable. The picture you see on the right is perhaps one of the best known examples of a giant superconducting magnet. And this is one of the other applications, superconducting magnets, which are extremely useful. For instance, to store energy, you can convert electricity into magnetic energy and back again losslessly. You can also use superconducting magnets for gearless motors, for example, in wind turbines. And probably you've already come across superconducting magnets. If you've had an MRI done, this is based on superconducting magnets. And now we're going to do the much talked about cool demo. So I'm going to show you a superconductor in action. So what you see here is a track made of magnetic material. So they're rails made of magnetic material. And what I'm going to demonstrate to you is one of the amazing quantum properties of superconductors that make them not only conduct electricity with no loss, but also repel magnetic fields. So what I have here is a puck of superconducting material. And so I'm going to position this over the rail so you can see it levitate. And actually, it started going without my doing anything. So you can see it levitate over the track. OK, excellent. Now we're going to try something else. What we're going to try to do is also turn the rail upside down and try to levitate a superconductor underneath the rail, which would be even cooler. So what I'm going to now do is take a very similar superconducting puck and position it now under the rail. Yeah, levitating underneath. You can see it fly without any dissipation except for primarily air friction underneath the rail. So what this is due to is because of persistent currents being set up on the surface of the superconductor that expel magnetic fields. And so this is one of the most dramatic consequences of superconductivity. So I've shown you, you've seen superconductors work, and I told you about all their amazing applications. So a question you might indeed ask is, why aren't superconductors everywhere? Why don't we see them much more in everyday life? Why aren't power transmission cables already made out of superconductors? One of the reasons is that these materials only superconduct below a certain superconducting temperature. And so if you notice, one of the pieces of kit I have here is a bucket with liquid nitrogen in it, which I needed to cool the superconductor in for it to work. So in order for these materials to become more applicable, it would be excellent if we had a material that was able to superconduct at a higher temperature. So we'd like to be able to find such higher temperature superconductors. So I got really excited by the prospect of working with superconductors. Who wouldn't like to do this as a day job? So I started trying to understand superconductors, and it turns out that this intricate quantum dance that the electrons do to create superconductivity, especially in these best-known superconductors, the ones with the highest superconducting temperature, are actually not understood. So we don't understand why these materials superconduct at such high temperatures. As one of the mysterious things we don't understand, this material I showed you that's superconducting is almost an insulator. Now, when I say insulator, you think of paper, of wood, materials that don't carry electricity, forget perfect conductors. So this is just one of the many mysteries of why are these materials that are almost insulators perfect conductors instead? And so there's many mysteries we don't understand about these superconductors, and it's tremendously exciting to work on these cool materials and try to understand them. But it also occurred to me at that point that even if I understood how these materials work, which is really important, would that enable me to make a new superconductor out of a new material? Actually, no. To discover a new material that's a good superconductor, this requires different kind of thinking. I need to be able to think in terms of relating materials to superconductivity. This becomes a materials question. So then I started thinking about how am I going to find a new material to make it a superconductor? And I thought about, historically, how have superconductors been found? So the vertical axis on here is superconducting temperature, and the horizontal axis is the year in which they were found. So the early superconductors were discovered 100 years ago, and these had low superconducting temperatures. And it was only about 20 years ago that there was a breakthrough, and materials which superconducted above liquid nitrogen temperatures, like the one I showed you just here, were discovered. And this was a great breakthrough. But if you look at this graph, it looks quite random. And the reason for this is all these materials were discovered serendipitously. By a happy accident, someone was working on something else and then happened to discover that one of these materials superconducted. Now, this is great. It's nice that this happened. But it's not a good way forward. It's not a directed way in which we can find better superconductors. And so it's an incredible challenge given that these electrons in superconductors need to behave as a quantum collective to create superconductivity. It's an incredible challenge to try and find a new material that's a superconductor. So in thinking about how to create new superconductors, it was almost a question of looking at a scrambled Rubik's Cube and looking at all these elements and trying to think, how do I put them together into this compound that superconducts? And this is challenging. We don't even understand existing superconductors. We don't have a pattern, a template, for how to put these elements together to get a better superconductor or even another new superconductor. But then looking at the existing high-temperature superconductors and similar other superconductors, it struck me that actually there are patterns to these materials. that may be incredibly helpful in developing a new superconducting material. And so possibly what we could do is utilize the fact that these materials that are superconductors were almost magnets, or almost insulators, or almost charge-ordered materials. And what this might help us do is start with a material that's a magnet, or a charge-ordered material, or an insulator. These are in abundance, right? We don't have superconductors in abundance, but we do have magnets and insulators in abundance. So what if we took that as a starting point and anticipate it's very close to being a superconductor? So let me apply a little force to it and see if it becomes a superconductor. This could be an amazing directed way to make superconductors instead of this hoping for a random act to create a superconductor. This could be a directed way in which to create new superconductors. And this was also especially appealing to me because I am familiar with technologies to apply these large forces on materials. This is me working with a giant magnet. Other ways are to apply large pressures, to apply large electric fields. So I thought, okay, let's start with picking a material, apply force to it. So for criteria to pick a material, I looked at existing superconductors and what these materials had in common. And one of the criteria was that it seemed that these materials weren't dense three-dimensional materials, but they seemed to be layered or stretched in one direction. Another criteria, as I briefly mentioned, these materials seem to be almost magnets, so have strong magnetic interactions, and these are represented by the yellow streaks on here, or strong charge interactions. And a final criteria was that what we found so counterintuitive, that starting with materials that are poor metals or insulators, this may be an excellent starting point. So based on these criteria, I picked a material, iron arsenide. So this is a magnet, and it's actually a poor metal. So it has a high resistance to the flow of electricity. So I started with this material, and the blue region on here shows you the starting magnetism of this material. So the vertical axis is temperature, and the horizontal axis is the amount of pressure I applied to it. So I synthesized single crystals of this iron arsenide and then placed a small crystal between the tips of a diamond anvil cell. So this is a type of contraption that applies pressure, and quite high pressures that reach sizes similar to near the Earth's core where actually new materials are created. And so I took this material, put a crystal between the tips of a diamond anvil cell, started pressing on it, and you can see the temperature go down. So this is the magnetic temperature. So the magnetic temperature going down means it's becoming less and less good a magnet, which is promising. But then at about 5% of a compression in volume of the crystal lattice, it's transformed into a new superconductor, which is amazing. We started with a magnet that was an insulator. We applied pressure on it, and it dramatically transformed into a superconductor. This is almost a form of quantum alchemy. And this is just the tip of the iceberg. We've started with materials that are not superconductors, changed them into a superconductor, and we know that materials are plentiful. We have a limitless array of materials which we can transform into superconductors. We just need to use the right criteria to pick them, use large forces on them, and we'll have an entire array, an explosion of new superconductors, where before we had one and two examples. So we're looking at a materials landscape. These are just two of the new examples of materials which I'm working on to transform into superconductors with promising results. So what we're looking at is a materials landscape. We're populating this with new superconductors with the aim of getting to the summit of a higher temperature superconductor. But along the way, we're creating many superconductors which will give us this ability to optimize materials to create this ultimate high temperature superconductor. And this will have a transformative impact on everyday life. So this, what we're witnessing here, is just the dawn of a new materials era, and it's going to lead to a revolution which will surpass even the Industrial Revolution. Thank you.